everybody. Welcome to my channel. I am so excited about today's study. I hope that it will be very beneficial to you. It was on my heart since this morning to talk about this. Today, I want to talk about the difficult times. The times where we feel like God is not there, or he's too late, or he has forgotten about us, and we're just sitting here wondering what happened to the promise that you made me, what happened to the comfort that you promised me. What do we do in these times? Is God really a good father, or does our ability to feel this love change with the circumstances? So let's just open up in prayer and get into the study. Father God, we thank you. Hallelujah. Thank you, God, for this moment. I thank you for everybody watching this video. I pray that the seed is planted in good ground. May you take over, God. May your Holy Spirit take over in this very second. And may your words flow, not mine. May this biblical truth be firmly planted in the viewer's heart. And may the person watching this video, the people watching this video, renew their mind and understand that you are truly a good father. No matter the circumstances, no matter the difficulties, no matter the obstacles, that you're still here, that you're still in control. Amen. I'm sorry, the lighting is gonna change a little because the window's open and, you know, there's a big tree behind the window, so the lighting is gonna vary, so I apologize for that. Let me turn down the volume a little bit. This song is Reckless Love by Stephanie Gretzinger, and I discovered it a few weeks ago, and it just overwhelms me. She talks about the love of God and how God is ready to leave the 99 sheep just because one is lost and go after him, and that we don't deserve this love, but he still does it because he just loves us that much. So take your Bibles. We're gonna read John 10. No, we're not gonna read John 10. I'm sorry. We're gonna read John 11. It's the story of Lazarus. And if you are a Christian, or if you grew up in a Christian family or in Christian school, maybe you've heard of this story before, but I really want to go in depth today and make sure that you guys really understand, you know, what really happened there, what God did in this story. So John chapter 11. So in John chapter 11, it's the death of Lazarus, and Lazarus was Jesus' friend. So before we get into the story, I want you guys to understand, for maybe non-Christian people who are not saved yet watching this video, that Jesus came on earth as fully man and fully God, because we needed a living sacrifice to redeem humanity. He had to come in the form of a human, but he was fully God. The scripture tells us that the fullness of the power of the Spirit of God was trapped in one body until the sacrifice was made, and then the Spirit was blown on humanity. And then after, in Acts, you see how the apostles, they received the Holy Spirit, and then it came like a fire, and then they started their mission. Because before Jesus came, the Holy Spirit did not enter in body. The Holy Spirit was still living and active. Actually, in John first, at the beginning, there was light, and there was the Word, and everything was made from this word. And the word is the Holy Spirit. And then it says that the word was made flesh and it lived among us. It came to us. And that's Jesus, fully God, made fully man to do what he had to do to come to us. So this story happens when Jesus is on earth. So, in the human body, fully God in a human body. And he had a friend called Lazarus, okay? So now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. So Mary and Martha were Lazarus' two sisters. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus was lay sick, was the same who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. Maybe you know this story. It's not Mary, the mother of Jesus, but it's that Mary who cleaned Jesus' feet and with her hair. So the sister sent the word to Jesus, "Lord, the one you love is sick." When he heard this, Jesus said, "This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." Now, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days, and then he said to his disciple, let us go back to Judea. So Jesus was somewhere else. So Martha and Mary, they sent someone to tell Jesus that Lazarus was very sick. And then Jesus, he didn't go right away. He stayed, finished what he was doing, and then 2 days later, he left. He decided to leave. And the disciple said, "But Rabbi, a short while ago the Jews were trying to stone you, and you were going back there." Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours in the day?" So I want us to stop there a little. So the story is telling us that Lazarus, someone who Jesus loves, was sick. And then Martha and Mary, they send someone to tell Jesus that there's a problem, there's a situation. So this makes me think of us. Us as Christians, when we face a difficulty and we talk to God about it. We go to God and we say, "God, I have this issue. God, I have a family member who's sick. Or God, I am sick. Or God, I'm going through some financial difficulties. Or God, I'm living something that is so difficult and I desperately need your help. I'm calling out to you, please help me." So that's what Martha and Mary, that's what they did. They sent someone to call Jesus because they knew that Jesus could fix the problem. But what happened? They said that Jesus stayed 2 days in the place where he was before leaving and going to Martha and Mary. And this got me thinking, the concept of time. We go to God with a problem because we think that he can help us and we think that he has a solution. But the problem is the timing, because we want our problems to be fixed right away. Or maybe we have a timeline in our head of how it should go or when it should be done. But Jesus didn't come right away. He stayed 2 days to finish what he was doing. And then If we continue reading, when he decided to go, the disciple said, "Why are you going back there? A few days ago, the Jews were trying to stone you," because at that point, they are after Jesus. Jesus' ministry has started. He's raising the dead. He's healing the sick. He is transgressing the law because he's healing people on the day of the Sabbath. And now people, the Jews, they want the glory for them. So they don't want people to follow Jesus. So at that point, they're already trying to catch him and kill him. And he said that he's going. And what that makes me think of is that song I'm listening to. The lyric says, you leave the 99, you go after me, you chase me until I am found. And Jesus, and the word in Matthew 18, verse 12, Jesus tells us that if a shepherd has 100 sheep and he loses just one, then he will leave everything behind. He will leave the 99 on the mountain so he can go after the one who is lost. Matthew 18, let's read it. Matthew 18, verse 12. He said, if a man has 100 sheep and one of them wanders away, what will he do? Won't he leave the 99 others on the hills and go out to search for the one that is lost? And if he finds it, I tell you the truth, he will rejoice over it more than over the 99 that didn't wander away. In the same way, it is not my heavenly Father's will that even one of these little ones should perish. So God goes after you. Before we continue this study, I want you to know and I want you to believe that God is a God who chases us. If he was not a God who chased us, Jesus, he would not need to come in the form of man to save humanity. A portion of God would not need to be embodied in a human flesh to save humanity by grace through faith. It's because he loves us that he brought heaven down to us. It's because he loves you that he's willing to leave everything that he has just to chase after you. He does not care about what you did wrong. He does not care about what you lack. But if you're lost, if your heart grows weary, and if you grow away from him, he will go after you because he loves you this much. So do you believe this? John 10, chapter 10 says that the enemy comes to rob, steal, and destroy. But Jesus has come so we may have life and have it abundantly. John 10, 10. He has come so we may have life and that we may have it abundantly. So if we continue the story of Lazarus in John 11, we see that after he had said this, he went on to tell them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to wake him up. So Lazarus is dead. So Jesus is saying, he is dead, but I'm going there to wake him up. So we're like, Jesus, what are you saying? What are you telling us? And oftentimes when we are going through difficult times, God is making us hold on to a promise that seems unrealistic, that seems to go beyond our human logic. It's something that we do not understand. It's like you don't see a way, but he's telling you that there is a way. Just like Moses in front of the sea, he said that he would make the Israelites like go through the sea. But in the natural, when you look at the water, you're like, how are we going to do it? So God is often asking us to hold on to things that we do not understand in the natural. Then Thomas said to the rest of the disciple, let us also go that we may die with him. So the disciples did not understand what Jesus was saying. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. So Jesus left 2 days after he learned that Lazarus was sick. So if we calculate, I think it took him like about 2 days to actually get to the other city. And then Lazarus was already dead. Now Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them for the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been there, my brother would not have died, but I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. So Martha has faith. She comes and then she says, okay, God, you are too late. I asked you to do something and you know, you got there too late. My brother's already dead, but I still believe in you. I still believe that, you know, God can still you know, your Heavenly Father can still give you whatever you ask. But then Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? Yes, Lord, she replied. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who is come to the world. So after that, she went and she told Mary, who was inside, that Jesus was there. So Mary comes, and then she, when Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in his spirit. Where have you laid him? He asked. Come and see, Lord, they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, see how he loved him? But some of them said, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying? Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. Then Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? And when Jesus asked them to roll the stone away, they said, but Master, he has been dead for 4 days. He's always been dead and he smells. And then Jesus said, didn't I tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? And then they rolled the stone away, and then you know what happened. Jesus took authority, asked Lazarus to wake up, and then he woke up. Oh my God. I think that this story is so powerful. So Jesus gets there, and he is already dead. Lazarus is already dead. So this is our case when we live something and then we feel like God is too late, because maybe our family member is already dead. Maybe we feel like we've been sick for too long. Maybe we feel like there's no hope for our financial situation. Maybe we feel like there's no hope for a marriage. Whatever the situation is. Whatever it is, maybe the doctors are telling you that because of your disease, you will not be able to have a baby, and you and your husband or you and your wife, you desperately want a baby, and you feel like the situation is dead. You feel like the diagnosis has been pronounced. You feel like everything is already dead because God is too late. So that's what happened. And then we go to God and we say, God, if you had been there, just like Mary and Martha was saying, Lord, if only you had been there, my brother would not have died. God, if only you had showed up for me, this would not have happened. If only you were here for me, God. God, if only you had heard my cries, I would not be suffering this much. But God, you let it happen. So we feel like God had betrayed us because he was not there to rescue us. But then, what did Jesus say? Jesus said that he is sleeping, but I will wake him up. So in the natural, your situation is already dead, but God is telling you that he has a way even if you do not see a way. So God tells you, okay, your situation might seem dead and you might think that there is no way out, but I am able to do something that you have never seen before. And you wonder, what, God? What can happen now? It's all said and done. What can you do now? You were too late. You were not here when I cried out to you. You were not here when I called your name. And now you're telling me that there is no way, even though I see no way. So our understanding is limited. We see with our natural eyes, and we realize that we do not see a way. We don't see how we are going to get out of the hole. We do not understand how we will be able to get healed. We do not understand how we are going to have a godly relationship, a godly marriage. We do not understand how we are going to turn our business situation around. We simply do not understand in the natural. And then we blame God and we tell him how late he is because we think that What we see is what actually is. So in verse 40, Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" So Jesus is asking them to believe in front of a dead situation. In front of a dead situation, he is telling them, "Have I not told you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" He did not say, "Have I not told you that if you work harder, you will see the glory of God? Have I not told you that if you worship two times or one more time, you will see the glory of God?" And all of these things are great, but he just said one thing. "Have I not told you that if you simply believe, if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" And can you imagine the situation where he's already, he's thinking, he's been dead for 4 days. But what really intrigues me in this story is that Martha and Mary, they've seen the glory of God. Even the disciple at that point, they had seen the glory of God. They had seen Jesus raising the dead, healing the sick, making miracles. And now he comes to in front of Lazarus' dead body and he said, "Roll the stone." And they were like, "Oh no, Jesus, he's smelling already." And when you read this, you're like, what were they thinking? They have seen the power of the living God, and he is asking you to roll the stone, and you are still doubting? You are questioning what he is asking you to do? But when we read this, don't we think about ourselves? We lose sight of eternity because we're so focused on what we see with our natural eyes. We lose sight of the promises of God because we think that he is too late and that he is no longer in control. And even when Jesus is asking you to roll the stone of your dead situation, you are still arguing with him because you lose focus of the promises that are yes and amen. So, what are you facing today? What situation is dead today in your life? What have you stopped believing today? Are you choosing your circumstances, or are you choosing the Word of God, which is sealed and eternal in heaven? Sealed and eternal. Doesn't matter what happens, doesn't matter what you see, the Word of God is alive, living, and active, sharper than a double-edged sword. And it's still active if only you believe. And now I want you to focus on the power of words. When we live a situation, what comes out of your mouth? Are you proclaiming death over your already dead situation, or are you proclaiming life because you know that the Word of God has the power to give life to even dead situation? The Bible tells us that the same Spirit who rose Christ from the dead lives on the inside of us. The Holy Spirit, the Spirit of the living God, when you accept Jesus Christ, he lives on the inside of us. So that means that you have the power to march over serpents and demons and all the forces of the enemy, and nothing can come against you. The Bible tells you this. So what have you done with this power that is inside of you? Are you using your power to proclaim death, or are you using your power to bring life to everything? I do not care what you are facing today. If we take Hebrews 3, verse 14. Hebrews 3, verse 14 says, "We have come to share in Christ if indeed we hold our original conviction firmly to the very end. And what I like about this is because it says that if we hold on to the conviction that we had at the beginning, in other version it says if we do not lose the hope that we had at the beginning, it's because God knows that we are not perfect. He knows that it's a constant battle for us between the spirit and the flesh, between what we feel and what we see, and between what we know and the word of God to be sealed in eternity. But the word of God said that we will share everything with Christ. Christ has everything. He said that everything that's on earth and in heaven belongs to him. Everything. So in him you have health. In him you have abundance. In him you have joy. In him you have peace. In him you have, you know, eternal joy. And he is telling you that everything that is in Christ is with you if you remain in him, and if you believe, if you cling to the faith that you had at the beginning. And it says at the beginning, why? It's because he knows that circumstances of life are gonna come against you and gonna come against your faith. He knows that there are times where we're gonna doubt. There are times when we are not gonna be able to believe in the word, because what we see with our eyes is gonna be the opposite of what God has promised us. But he said to cling to the faith that we had at the beginning. You need to remind yourself, you need to renew your mind. In 2 Corinthians 10 tells us, we demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. You need to renew your mind. It says to take your thoughts captive and put them under the obedience of Christ. You know, when you face a difficult situation, in a situation that might seem dead, you need to fight with the word of God. Jesus, before raising Lazarus from the dead, he said, Father, I thank you that you have already answered my prayers. He started by declaring the word of God. He started taking authority, and that's what you need to do. When circumstances come, when obstacles come, you need to fight not with your flesh, but with the word of God, because the Bible tells us that we are not fighting against flesh and blood, but we are fighting against spirits, against evil spirits of darkness. So that means that you cannot just think that you will respond to obstacles with your flesh and that your problems will be resolved. You cannot think that you will just drown yourself in alcohol or just like smoke a joint and that your problems will go away. You cannot think that whenever you feel depressed or you feel like you're not good enough, that you're just gonna go to bed, you're just gonna jump in bed with someone, have multiple sex partners, have sex outside of marriage, and that's gonna fix your problem. You cannot think that bashing others is what's gonna make you feel better about yourself. You cannot think that sleeping with a man who's married or sleeping with a woman who's married is what's gonna make you feel complete, because then you're just going to, you know, you're just gonna keep sinning and keep obeying to Satan, and then while God is just trying to make you complete. There is a place in each person's heart that only God can fill. But if you're trying to fix it with your flesh, what good are you doing? So when you're facing a situation, are you truly using the word of God? Philippians 4 verse 6 to 7 tells us. Philippians 4 verse 6 to 7 tells us, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer, petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Jesus Christ. So he said, first of all, do not be anxious. But in every situation, he's not telling us that when everything is good, just praise God. He said, in every situation, rejoice in the Lord. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer, petition, pray without ceasing. Prayer, petition, and with thanksgiving. Jesus, before raising Lazarus from the dead, he thanked the Heavenly Father to say thank you because he had already heard his prayer and he already knew that he was already capable of doing what he was about to ask. So he said, with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding. He said, you know, Jesus promised something and it was peace. He said that he did not promise that peace will come when everything is good. He said that we will have trouble in the world, but that we should guard our hearts and protect our peace because he has already overcome the world. So what Jesus promises is not a fix quick to our problems, but he said that if we remain in him, if we stay rooted in him, if we are anchored in him and we cling to the word of truth, that he will give us peace that transcends all understanding. And the peace that he's talking about is above and beyond every logic. That means that he will not wait till your situation is fixed so he can give you joy and he can give you peace. But if you present your request to him, if you present your burden to him, he said, come to me, all those who are tired and weary, and I will give you rest. So if you come and you bring your situation, even if you think that it's too late, and you bring it to him, he will give you the peace and give you patience and the strength to wait until he brings you the solution to your problem. And another thing is that faith, what is faith? Faith comes from the word of God, because faith comes from what we hear. So in the times of trouble, we have a tendency to be mad at God and to stop praying, stop reading our Bibles. But it is in these times that the enemy will try to plant seeds in your heart. So when you are going through something that's very difficult, it is in these times that you need to really pray more. It is in these times that you need to worship, even if you don't see a way, even if you have to worship with tears in your eyes, even if you have to weep, you need to go to your Father, go to Jesus. He has already paid the price. He has already promised you peace that surpasses understanding. So we need to go to him, and we need to stop thinking that the solution is somewhere else. We need to fix our eyes on the cross, where he has already paid the price for us, and he has promised us that if we receive him, if we go to him, if we accept him as our Lord and Savior, we will be with him in heaven, that he has already a place for us, and that he will guard our hearts in Jesus, our hearts, our mind, and our spirits in Jesus Christ. And the last thing is that you need to renew your mind daily. Renew your mind. Don't focus on what you can see, because we see that even when Lazarus was dead and that everybody thought that he was already late, like the Jews were saying, oh, he healed the blind, but he couldn't save Lazarus. And we have a tendency to think that we know how God should operate. We know when and how he should operate. But God is telling us that he does not owe us time. God does not take time or borrow time. He created time. So God is actually outside of time. I want you to picture this in your mind for a second. He is placed outside of time. There's no deadline. There's no limit. He holds everything in his hand, including time. So let's renew our mind and trust that he is still in control. No matter what you are going through, I know it's hard. I know you might not see a way, but in Jesus, there is always a way.
For you now, I stand beside.